Mishpacha. It's Courtney, America's Jewish mother. And as I'm filming this, it is Wednesday, November 4th, and it's about 1:30 in the afternoon, the day after the general election in the United States, and we still don't know what the outcome is, and may not even know it until sometime next week or even later, because you know what would be so fun? To stretch out this anxiety-inducing process even longer. Because, you know, that's what 2020 is about. It's all about just the worst of every possible thing. Okay, I'm gonna stop ranting now. But yeah, so anyway, I've come on here while we're all still in a state of chaotic uncertainty to tell you why I gave 3 stars to Ibram X. Kendi's How to Be an Anti-Racist. So I'm gonna take this in terms of discussing what I felt like were the positives of the book, and then I'm gonna talk about what I feel like were the drawbacks of the book, and then I think once you sort of holistically add all that stuff together, for me it came out to a 3-star review of the book. So on the plus side, at the beginning of every chapter, Kendi defines his terminology for the reader. So he defines racism and anti-racism. Oh no, I should also add that literally every chapter is tied somehow to racism and anti-racism. It's just different variants. So at the very, very beginning, he tells you what the definitions of racism and anti-racism are. And then in later chapters, he tells you what class racism and class anti-racism are, or cultural racism and cultural anti-racism, or biological racism and biological anti-racism, etc., etc. So I like that he includes definitions of terms so that you as the reader and he as the author are on the same page as far as what he is talking about. And I think I've said this before, when I've talked about this book, but I think oftentimes, especially in academic settings, we all assume that we're working with the same definition of a term, when in fact we are not, and there are multiple ways to define a term, so I like that he did that. I also like that his book was focused on the practical consequences of our actions, so in other words, whatever your intention is matters less than what the actual practical consequences and outcomes are. Tied to that, I like that he emphasizes the importance of policy changes, because even if we manage to change the hearts and minds of every person in America with respect to racism, that doesn't do anything to eliminate the structural barriers that impede African-American progress in this country. So I liked that there was a focus on practical consequences, especially with respect to policy. Again, that very much would have appealed to the pragmatist in me, who's always sort of thinking about what are the practical consequences of, you know, this or that action or this or that belief, etc., etc. He also includes a lot of data and statistics in this book, alongside personal anecdotes that pretty much bookend every chapter of the book. So at the beginning of the chapter, he'll start telling a personal anecdote, and then that'll segue into whatever the topic of the chapter is, and all of the chapters, you know, have a title like biology, ethnicity, culture, class, capitalism, etc., etc. And then, you know, in the course of the chapter, he'll give a lot of data and statistics, and then at the end of the chapter, he'll come back around to finish the personal anecdote that he started at the beginning. And I thought that was all good. You know, I teach first year composition, and one of the things my students have been learning about recently are the 3 rhetorical appeals, logos, pathos, and ethos. And I feel like by citing outside sources and citing a lot of data and statistics and including personal anecdotes, Kendi nicely covers all 3 of the rhetorical appeals, which I liked. And I feel like is a rhetorically effective strategy. I also really liked his chapter on racial capitalism. And in fact, after that chapter, he starts talking about racism and capitalism as, I think, the conjoined twins, at least the twins, it might be the conjoined twins. But I think that's really important that we acknowledge that racism and capitalism are inextricably linked. And so I think it's good that he not only makes that point in that chapter, but then repeatedly comes back to it throughout the rest of the book. And I also like that the book ends on a hopeful note because, as you know, I hate it when books point out problems and don't offer any kind of solution. I at least liked that he ended on a hopeful note for the future. That also quite appealed to me. So, getting into the things that I did not like as much about this book. So, as much as I liked the chapter on racial capitalism, I had big problems with his chapters on gender and sexuality. So, in the chapter on gender, he talks about how he has read all of these influential black feminist thinkers like Audre Lorde and bell hooks and Kimberly Crenshaw. And you know, that's all well and fine, and I'm really glad that Kendi has read these foundational texts, but the discussion that followed kind of made me wonder if he's read anyone who's written about black feminism since the year 2000, especially because he coins the terms, because again, he's so, you know, he's so committed to tying everything to either racism or anti-racism. So at the beginning, he coins these terms gender racism and gender anti-racism, and there's a perfectly good term that already exists for what Kendi calls gender racism, and that term is misogynoir, and that has existed for at least 10 years. So Kendi doesn't include, you know, any sort of current voices in this discussion. There's no Roxane Gay, there's no Brittany Cooper, there's no Moya Bailey, who actually coined the term misogynoir. So I was, you know, I was not super impressed that, you know, in this chapter he really only talks about how he's read foundational writers and not anyone more current than that. And again, I would rather he read the foundational workers, I mean, the foundational writers than not read anyone. But I think if you're, you know, if you're writing a book in like 2017, 2018, I mean, I assume this is when he was writing it since it was published in 2019. You know, you would think that it would probably be good to refer to more content, and especially because he works in academia, that it would be good to refer to more contemporary research into the subject of black feminism rather than just focusing on stuff that was primarily written in the 70s and 80s and a little bit of the early 90s. So that was one. Similarly, I had big problems with his chapter on sexuality. In that chapter, he really only refers to homosexuals, which just feels like a very outdated term. I don't use that term anymore. It feels very sort of clinical and medical and, you know, like something people would say in the 80s and 90s, but don't really say so much anymore. And he does not acknowledge that sexuality is a spectrum. He acknowledges that gender is a spectrum, which is great, but as someone who identifies as bisexual, I was like, where am I in this conversation? So there's just reference to homosexuals, and no reference to, you know, people who are bisexual or pansexual or asexual, etc. So I felt like that was definitely an oversight on Kendi's part. So I was not too pleased with that. I also really don't like that he strongly devalues other approaches to ameliorating the problem of racism in America other than policy change. So basically he thinks if you're not actively working and pursuing policy change, then you're not doing anything. So he really devalues the approach of moral suasion. He doesn't think that it's important to change people's hearts and minds. And while I agree that you do need policy change, as I've already said, I think we actually need both. I think the Supreme Court case, Obergefell v. Hodges, which legalized same-sex marriage back in 2014 maybe? 2013, 2014, something like that. I don't think that would have necessarily passed had we not been at a sort of critical mass of opinion in the mainstream US that we were cool with gay people and gay marriage. Even as recently as 2008, both Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton, who were, you know, primary candidates for the Democratic ticket, were both on record as saying that they did not support same-sex marriage in 2008, and then it passed at the Supreme Court level, you know, like I said, 2014, 2015, whatever that was. So fewer than 10 years later. So I feel like you actually need both. You need policy changes, but you also need kind of like a critical mass opinion where everyone's like, yes, we're on board with this. So I think we need both moral suasion and policy changes, and I don't like that Kendi devalues the moral suasion approach. Especially because he himself works at a policy research center, and we can't all do that. Like, we can't all just quit our regular jobs and, you know, start working at a center that specifically pursues policy changes. I don't appreciate as a teacher that, like, what I'm doing in the classroom, which is basically trying to teach my students the importance of a diversity of viewpoints and other opinions and to be critical thinkers about things. Like, I don't appreciate that that approach is being devalued and that the work that I'm doing is being devalued. So, definitely wasn't on board with that. I also don't like that he just, you know, repeatedly devalues W.E.B. Du Bois throughout the entire book. I feel like W.E.B. Du Bois, like, was turned into his personal punching bag because Du Bois, you know, lived 100 years ago or was writing 100 years ago. I think he actually died in, I want to say, like, 1960-something. But anyway, I don't like that he just seemed to have a real axe to grind with W.E.B. Du Bois because Du Bois had different ideas about what needed to happen in the United States and different ideas about what constituted racism. And really, Kendi specifically takes a critical approach to the fact that Du Bois was a sort of assimilationist thinker, and Du Bois thinks that assimilationism is just another form of racism. And again, I understand why he thinks that based on his explanation of it. But again, I think we should not necessarily just discount everything W.E.B. Du Bois did for the African-American community and African-American literature as a whole, just because he doesn't have the same operational definition of racism and anti-racism as Kendi does in, you know, the year 2019. The other thing is, I listened to this on audiobook, as you know, so I don't know if James Baldwin got mentioned at the end of the book in any sort of endnotes or citations in the physical copy of the book, but I can say that Kendi never once mentions Baldwin by name in the actual text of the chapters, which was weird to me because some of the stuff he talks about seems like it's ripped straight from the pages of The Fire Next Time. Especially Kendi's discussion of the Nation of Islam and how they sort of invert the dominant color hierarchy, right, of white good, black bad, to black good, white bad. That's exactly what Baldwin says in The Fire Next Time. So I thought it was weird that Kendi doesn't even mention Baldwin in the course of that conversation. I also did not like that I feel like Kendi sort of willfully misunderstands structural racism and institutional racism in order to advance his argument that I think is not a great argument, that black people can be racist. And I just feel like when we can't even get a majority of white people in this country to acknowledge that racism is structural, and that it is institutional in nature, that it's not really useful to advance an argument that black people can be racist. I think people of color who are in positions of power who do not use their position of power to help correct systemic and structural problems in the system should be held to account, but I think that's, you know, that's not the same thing as saying black people can be racist. So I don't think that's a good and useful argument that he makes in this book. And then the last thing I'm going to say about this book that I did not like about it is that ultimately I really feel like Kendi's book is designed to shut down conversation. Everything from the binary way in which he structures all of the chapters where everything's either tied to racism or anti-racism, the fact that he basically says that if you're not, you know, out there directly working for policy changes, you're not doing shit, to even the fact that at the end of the book, And sorry if this is a spoiler, he reveals that, both he and his wife have had forms of cancer and undergone treatment for those cancers. I feel like is also kind of designed to shut down conversation, because then, you know, I feel bad being like, well, I have all these problems with this book because he and his wife survived cancer, and, you know, now I feel like an ass, you know, because I have problems with the book. So yeah, I just feel like, this whole book is designed to shut down conversation, as opposed to something like Claudia Rankine's Just Us, which basically the whole point of this book is that you should keep having conversations with people, even if they're uncomfortable. Similarly, I am right now listening to Ijeoma Oluwa's So You Want to Talk About Race. I'm about 30% of the way through that on audiobook, and I have to say, I really like it a lot so far, and Oluwa also seems to be of the mindset that you really need to have uncomfortable conversations with people and keep talking even if it's hard. And I really like and appreciate that. And it's funny because Oluwa actually makes some of the same points that Kendi makes, but she makes them in a way that I guess sort of like make me feel like I'm more on board with it, if that makes sense. Or she presents them in a way that I don't feel like she's trying to shut down conversation, more or less. Okay, so that's pretty much my full review of Kendi's book. So again, I felt like between the all of the positives that I mentioned and all of the drawbacks that I mentioned, combined with sort of the overall importance of the topic, for me it averaged out to a 3-star rating overall. So if you have read this book and you have thoughts about it, I would love to hear your thoughts down in the comments below, so please feel free to leave me a comment. I hope y'all are doing well and staying healthy and not having too much angst over the fact that we still don't know who won the US election and might not know for weeks. So anyway, I hope you're staying well and I hope you're doing good reading. And until next time, would it kill you to call your mother?